Welcome to the motherfucking relay. We're covering today's top boxing news.
Anthony Dirrell versus David Benavidez. Let's talk about the fight. You know, this is more or less what I anticipated, though it did last two rounds longer than I thought it would. You know, I had David Benavidez getting Anthony Dirrell out of there in about 6 to 7 rounds. Took two more rounds than I thought it would. Okay. But this is more or less the aesthetic that I envisioned.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, Anthony Dirrell, he's experienced. He's been around the block. He's only got one professional loss, or only had one professional loss ahead of this fight. So he's a formidable guy. He's solid. But at the end of the day, there are certain subtleties, certain defensive lapses in judgment, small deficiencies, that against an interesting puncher like David Benavidez, those deficiencies would come back and bite Anthony in the ass. And that's indicative in the cut that was over his right eye. You know, that was a cut that was opened up by a jab that got through because of what I said in my prediction video, that sometimes, you know, Anthony Dirrell, he just doesn't get those hands high fast enough, so punches get through. And you can afford to have those deficiencies against an Avni Yildirim, but against a David Benavidez,
well,
it'll cost you. It's gonna cost you. And that's what resulted in that cut. I mean, you go back, you watch the footage on this thing, and he kind of just snuck that jab in there right in Anthony Dirrell's eye socket. Bad place for a cut. Inside of the socket, right on the eyelid. Every time you blink, that thing's opening up.
Ouch.
To be fair, I don't think that the cut affected the aesthetic of this fight as much as Fury's cut affected the aesthetic of his fight with Otto Valine. I don't think that the cut was as big a problem for Anthony as it was for Tyson Fury. But nevertheless, it was a cut that was caused by one of the deficiencies that I highlighted in my prediction video. For what it's worth, Anthony fought a good fight. I mean, he did. You know, he made it last, you know? Moving and punching, sticking and moving. Because you don't want to be a stationary target for the likes of David Benavidez. You're better off fighting on the fly. Buy yourself some time. Pump that jab out there. Because David's already walking you down. You know, he's already trying to corner you so that he can unload. In that situation, one thing you can do is to use your jab as a deterrent to get this guy to cover up. Because when he's covering up, he's not throwing punches at you. You know, that's basically the rhyme and the reason. That he's already walking you down. He's already trying to corner you. In that situation, use that jab as a deterrent. Get this guy on the defensive in spots.
In moments.
So that he doesn't spend the whole time swinging for the fences on you. Because that's likely what would have happened had Anthony Dirrell been more stationary or opened up a bit too much. You know, there's a reason he consistently went out there throwing singles, pot shots, using that jab. That as David Benavidez approaches, Anthony Dirrell sticks out that jab, snaps it out there to get that guy to cover up. Buy Anthony some time to get out of there. Get on the move, stay on the move. Smart tactic. Cagey veteran. But, you know, David, he did get the stoppage, and that's more or less what I was expecting him to do. You know, this fight isn't the kind of fight to where you can attribute its aesthetic or its outcome to a single blow, a telltale shot that turned things around. Now, it wasn't that kind of fight. It's for this reason I don't even overstate the relevance of the cut, because for what it's worth, even after Anthony got cut, he was very much still in that fight. He was still making it competitive in spots. So this wasn't that kind of fight. This was more or less a systemic breakdown, a systemic beating. That on one end, you've got Anthony Dirrell exhausting what energy reserves he has by constantly navigating the ring to offset David Benavidez's aggression. You know, all of this stuff. There's no such thing as a free lunch. You moving around that ring as much as you are, it is costing you. But when he's not moving around the ring, when David Benavidez manages to pin him down in a corner and unload some punches, some of these shots are actually getting through. Shots downstairs, shots upstairs, a stab to the body here, a hook up top there, you know? All of this stuff is gradually breaking down Anthony Dirrell, round by round. David Benavidez is slowly chipping away at this guy. He didn't start off guns blazing, swinging for the fences. No, David Benavidez got into a groove, got into a rhythm, and I'd say after the first quarter of the fight, you saw that David Benavidez has found his range. He's connecting with more interesting punches. As the fight progressed, the holes in Anthony Dirrell's defense were just becoming bigger and bigger as the fight progresses. The holes that I talked about in my prediction video, that Anthony's got his virtues. He's a solid fighter, but at the end of the day, defensively, he is lacking a bit. And against a more interesting puncher than the guys he's faced so far, it's going to cost him. And that's basically what happened. I'll say that, you know, in moments he had some good rallies. You know, he tried to put some punches together in spots, though many of those shots were caught on the arms and gloves of David Benavidez. Many of those shots not actually breaking through, doing any kind of significant damage or even getting David's respect, because had they, David wouldn't have been the aggressor the majority of the fight, mm-hmm. you know, if Anthony actually did get his respect, but that's not the case. The vast majority of this fight, the aesthetic was David Benavidez is the aggressor. He's walking his man down, and even though it gets interesting in spots, for the most part, David is the guy on the front foot. David is the guy pouring it on, and it's growing more and more difficult the situation for Anthony Dirrell. He's done his best to work around and offset David Benavidez's aggression, his punching power, and his imposing size. But overall, he can't contain this guy, he can't control this guy, and it's getting that much more difficult to contend with him. I think that, you know, what's most eye-catching about David Benavidez, at least to the casual observer, is his offense. But defensively, he has real virtues, because you'll notice he always angles his guard, so nothing gets through. You know, he's doing his best to prevent the other guy from scoring. Solid defensive prowess from David Benavidez, who made sure to catch those shots on the arms and gloves as he was bearing down on Anthony Dirrell. I mean, if you look at this thing, he really took minimal punishment throughout the course of this fight. It was a good stoppage. You know, Anthony Dirrell's corner, they decided to stop this thing because they could see where it was going. You could see where this was going. I could see where this was going. For a 34-year-old seasoned vet like Anthony Dirrell, there's no sense in letting this thing go on longer than it needs to, because it became very obvious that, you know, this guy's gonna end up getting seriously hurt. Throw in the towel, stop this thing. And they did the right thing. For their fighter, they did the right thing. I'll say, he fought valiantly. It was virtuous of him that he didn't go down at any point in the fight, but he did get stopped. You know, there was a stoppage the way I said there would be a stoppage. Solid showing, and with that, David Benavidez is once again the WBC super middleweight champion, and the world is his oyster right now. You know, possibilities with a Caleb Plant come into the conversation. You know, those two guys, they've had their war of words in the past. Hopefully that will result in a unification fight between the two, and it's everything I thought it would be. No more, no less. We then come to what was last night's main event. I think a fight that left a lasting impression on anyone that watched it. I mean, just in terms of entertainment value, this was well worth the price tag. And I expressed as much leading up to the fight that, you know, the fight between Sean Porter and Errol Spence has more potential of being competitive than what we had just seen in Spence versus Garcia. That fight really shouldn't have been a pay-per-view, but this one's worth the money. This one is worth the price tag, and it didn't disappoint. It really delivered. That in terms of entertainment value, you could not have been watching this fight and been bored.
At any moment.
Now, in my prediction video, I talked about how I wasn't expecting this fight to end in a knockout. No, sir, I was not expecting for Errol Spence to make good on his word that he would be the first to stop Sean Porter. I wasn't buying that story, because I had just watched Errol Spence lay into a blown-up lightweight, and he couldn't stop him. He threw 1,000 punches at the guy. He couldn't stop Mikey Garcia. So the idea that he's going to go in there and blast out Sean Porter, give me a break.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Nope!
Seems that Tom has proven me right. That Sean Porter could, quite honestly, quite possibly make things harder for Errol Spence than anybody Spence has faced so far. And yes, that includes Kell Brook. It seems I was right to assume as much. Let's talk about what we saw. You know, I'm sure there's no shortage of YouTube authors out there uploading their reaction videos in regards to this fight. How they see it, what they think went right, what they think went wrong, what's their reaction overall? Did Spence over or underperform? What do they think of Sean Porter? What do they think of the aesthetic of the fight? I'm sure there are no shortage of YouTube authors uploading their take on this fight, their version of the story. But if you want my opinion, and you're here, so I'll assume that you do, I feel that Sean Porter exposed many deficiencies in Errol Spence. That Sean Porter effectively negated Errol Spence's southpaw jab. He negated it so much so that whenever Sean Porter wanted to find his way in,
he did.
And there was very little that Errol Spence could do to keep him out. Let's talk about it. You know, think of the jab as the bouncer in a club. Before you can even get in, that's who's gonna greet you at the door. But in Errol's case, it seemed like his bouncer,
his jab,
had went out for a smoke break. An extended smoke break, because there was very little stopping Sean Porter from getting in. There was very little resistance from him getting into his desired range, and that is due to the deficiencies of Errol Spence's jab. But why are they deficiencies? Well, Errol Spence has a height advantage, a reach advantage. He's a southpaw. You're expecting that his jab should be coming over the top. of Sean Porter's orthodox jab, but that wasn't even the case. I mean, Errol's jab, it wasn't even a factor in this fight, because time and time again, round by round, when Sean wanted to get in, he got in. And he forced Errol Spence to fight his fight at his being Sean Porter's, at his desired range, deep in the pocket. And as this is going on, as Sean Porter is breaking through, Errol Spence is doing his best to fight him off. Battle back, firing off hooks, sweeping hooks that often hit nothing but air, sweeping hooks that Sean Porter successfully gets under.
Gets low.
Pivots so then he can attack Errol Spence from a different angle, forcing him onto those ropes, forcing Errol Spence into a dogfight. And that's a curious development, because that's not what I was expecting. It's not. It seems to me that while the fight might have started off more or less how I expected, somewhere down the line, Sean Porter made a conscious decision to start pouring on the pressure on Errol Spence. And it has to be because he noticed that Errol has neither the timing or the footing to stop Sean from breaking through, to stop Sean from getting in. That Sean Porter, he doesn't have to worry about Errol's southpaw jab, because it is simply not as good as advertised. That it's nowhere near as big a factor in the fight as previously, originally, anticipated. So he may have tweaked his original game plan. Sean might have gone in there thinking, I'm gonna pick my spots, choose my battles wisely, I'm not gonna stand right in front of this guy too much. He might have thought that going in, but little by little he realized that, you know what, this guy's jab, it's just not as advertised. It's not what I thought it was gonna be. This guy can't stop me from mauling him. And it's at that point in the juncture that Sean Porter decided to start pouring it on Errol, because he could see Errol's flustered. He's uncomfortable. He's giving up real estate. He's getting hit with clean shots, upstairs, downstairs. You know, footwork. Forget things like lead foot advantage when Errol Spence can't hold his position and maintain it, maintain distance and spacing when he's regularly giving up ground to the advancing Sean Porter, who Spence is struggling to keep out.
Keep off.
I mean, if the fight was fought where the fight was fought, if it was fought deep in the pocket, it's not because Spence wanted to fight the fight there, it's because Sean wanted to fight the fight there. And in that way, that would make Sean Porter the ring general more often than not. You know that Errol Spence is a mid-range, the outside guy. I mean, that's his preferred distance to land his best punches, where he generates his best power, mid-range to outside.
Not inside.
But not so deep in the pocket, not way on the inside, that it's like two guys fighting in a fucking crawl space. You know, essentially, it's a phone booth fight, to where the two guys are in such close proximity to each other that the work's not even clean. You know, they're right there. You know, elbow to elbow, chest to chest, swinging for the fences. That's not characteristic of an Errol Spence fight. That's characteristic of a Sean Porter fight. And if this is going on round by round, if this is continuously happening, if this dynamic is being imposed on Errol Spence, it's due to the deficiencies in his jab, his lack of timing, distance, spacing. He could not control the room and the real estate of the fight. Sean Porter imposed his will on Errol Spence, and Errol Spence was flustered by this. He's a guy who's accustomed to having things his way, getting a lot of respect from his opponent, whereas Sean's got moxie and Sean's got a chin. He's not gonna be intimidated by what Errol Spence has got. And that's what I saw in this fight. I mean, you ask me if the prediction stuck. What was I anticipating? I was anticipating Errol Spence winning this fight on points behind showing the cleaner boxing. The cleaner boxing of the two guys. That it'll be Errol Spence that has all the photo finish punches. But if you watch this fight, if you simply go back to this thing, how many photo finish punches did Errol Spence actually have? The majority of this fight was fought in a crawl space. And it's not because Errol wanted it there. That's not his desired range. You think of the condition of both the fighters. You know, Sean Porter is known for being a supreme athlete, a guy who can fight at a relentless pace for the full 12 rounds. Whereas Errol, you know, not only has he never had to fight someone like this, but this has never really been asked of him either. The kind of guys that he's fought up until this point have not posed that kind of resistance. Thus, that has never been asked of him. And his condition in this fight indicated that. He wasn't taking those punches up top, downstairs. He wasn't receiving those punches as well as he would have liked, as well as some people might have thought. That, you know, Sean Porter's not known for being a concussive puncher. He's not known for being a heavy hitter. But when you've got a guy who's constantly barreling down on you like this, roughing you up, pushing you around, out-muscling you, out-hustling you, suddenly those punches, they start to sting. They start to hurt. And Errol Spence's condition was really tested here. I mean, even now, there are people that feel Errol didn't win that fight. Sean won that fight. That's right. There are people out there right now screaming robbery. That Errol, you know, he wasn't in control of anything that was happening here. And I'm not even going to get into it. I'm not even going to get into the scorecards, how the judges had it, how you might have had it, how I had it, and why. I'm not going to get into that because it's besides the point. This fight revealed a lot of things about Errol Spence. It answered a lot of questions about this guy. This is a guy who some people think could go up there and fight a Gennady Golovkin, could go up there and fight a Canelo Alvarez. When I'm watching this guy, and he barely makes it past a Sean Porter. And this whole air of invincibility, this reputation that Errol Spence has as some kind of a boogeyman, it's all starting to come apart at the seams, fight by fight. I mean, with Mikey Garcia, the story was, okay, how's this guy a boogeyman when he's got to go to the judges with a goddamn blown-up lightweight? And the narrative, at least from Errol Spence's fans, is that, oh, well, Mikey's in survival mode. Errol can't land a clean shot. Oh, okay, well, Sean Porter wasn't in survival mode. Sean Porter is a guy who was constantly opening up on Errol Spence. So how do you explain that? You know, the whole time this fight is building up, leading up to this fight, you had a lot of guys that were trying to convince the world that Sean Porter doesn't have a shot in the dark, that Errol's going to go in there, he's going to starch him, he's going to knock him out. Hashtag man down.
Dicker.
I mean, that was the narrative. Yet we see here that these are the same guys who now have to explain away why Errol couldn't deliver. Why couldn't he put the guy down? Before you telling me he couldn't get the knockout because the guy was in survival mode, he wasn't opening up enough for Spence to land clean. Okay, fine. Well, what about this guy? This guy's constantly opening up. He's constantly standing in front of you. He's mauling you, pressuring you, bullying you, pushing you around. And Spence still couldn't get the knockout. He still couldn't get the knockout.
No.
You know, whether the guy's in survival mode or the guy's constantly opening up, one way or another, it seems to me that Errol Spence's power, it is simply not as advertised. And I reiterate, this reputation of his as being some kind of invincible boogeyman, it's all starting to fall apart like a house of cards. This guy ain't what you think he is. He's not. So I'll say this. While yesterday's fight was thoroughly entertaining and well worth the price tag, among those things, it was also very revealing. It was revealing in regards to Errol Spence and what kind of fighter he really is. When you look past the smoke, past the mirrors, past the production and the promos, a question of longevity needs to be asked because he's not performing to the level that people expect him to. He is not performing up to scratch. And I don't want to hear about how good a fighter Sean Porter is because, hey, you know what? Leading up to this fight, you were the guy saying he was going to get knocked out, and I had to remind you what kind of a fighter Sean Porter is, okay? The bottom line here is that this denotes what I've been telling you all along. Errol Spence is not as good a fighter as he's advertised, and it's for this reason they won't rush him into a Crawford fight. They won't put him in a risky situation like that when so much of what they're invested in is on the line. They can't control what happens to him if it's Crawford in the ring with him. And it's for this reason that, like I said before, I'm not expecting Errol Spence to fight Terrence Crawford after this, even if he wins. I'm not expecting that. I'm expecting him to do a round robin of PBC's guys, okay? That's what I'm expecting, because underneath it all, Errol isn't as good as you think he is.